I'm Robert Haas. I'm very grateful to you all for coming. The reason for this evening is to celebrate the extraordinary life and still more extraordinary art of Czeslaw Milosz, who taught in the Slavic languages department at Berkeley from 1961 to, I think he retired in 1981, but he actually came back and taught seminars in the English department well into the 90s. For many of us here, he was one of the astonishing facts about Berkeley, the University of California, and the art of poetry in the part of the 30 years of the 20th century that he lived here. There's a reception after this event down the hall in the English department lounge. It seems that Czeslaw used to always ask whenever we went someplace to do a reading together, he would ask how far it was to the restaurant from the place where we're reading, because he wanted to know when he was going to get to the first glass of wine or the first vodka. So anyway, this let you know that in 30 seconds after the reading ends, you can get a glass of wine down the hall. Also, in the same spirit, in his honor, even though it was 80 degrees when I left the house, Czeslaw's way of treating any occasion on the campus as a formality was to wear a tweed jacket. So I'm wearing my memorial tweed jacket. There are a lot of us here who not only loved his poetry, but loved him. He was born in Chitania, Lithuania, in the country of his grandparents and great-grandparents' manor houses, farms on a river in Lithuania in 1911. So we're gathered to celebrate the centenary of his birth, and this centenary is being celebrated all over the world. As far as I know, there are going to be centenary readings of his work in the United States, here in Berkeley, in the fall, in San Francisco, in Los Angeles, in Houston, in Chicago, in New York, in Ann Arbor, Michigan, in Paris, London, Berlin, Mexico City, Buenos Aires,
Venice,
Krakow, Warsaw, Gdansk, and I know a group of poets in
Dublin,
and I know a group of poets. Xi Xuan is organizing a reading of his poetry in Beijing in Chinese translation, and I know there'll be a reading of his poetry in Seoul in Korean translation. We'll try to talk about the reasons why he is a world poet, or why, because he's a poet on the order of Blake or Milton, it's almost impossible to represent his work by reading. That is, if you read the Songs of Innocence and Experience, you wouldn't get the late poems. If you read the late poems, you wouldn't get the parables. If you read this part of Milton, you wouldn't read. He's a poet of that order. So we've just asked people the simplest thing to do, mostly in English, though we're going to hear some poetry in Polish, to read the poems that are in the English language and the Polish language come to be in people's hearts. Ezra Pound, who Czeslaw had grave doubts about, remember him saying, I said, what do you think of Pound? He said, to be fooled by Stalin, okay, but to be fooled by Mussolini, unintelligible, he said. But Ezra Pound said, what thou lovest well remains, and so in a way what I hope we'll get tonight is that. A word about, most of you know, but a word for there are some undergraduates here who may not know, just a word about his life. He was born in 1911. His father was an engineer in the Russian army. Lithuania at that time was culturally a place where the gentry who owned the manor farms were Polish and spoke Polish and felt themselves to belong to Polish culture. the peasantry who worked the land, in whom there was a simmering nationalist rebellion, spoke Lithuanian. The Jews in the shtetl villages spoke Yiddish. Middle-class Jews who lived in the city spoke Russian, and the administration of the empire in which they functioned was Russian. It was in the Russian army that Milosz's father worked. And Czeslaw, with his father as a child, took many trips. I think he told me, I don't know if this is, that he saw his first automobile on Nevsky Prospect on a trip to St. Petersburg with his father. And another story that about traveling on the Siberian Express, in which the family took a Lithuanian peasant woman who was a family servant with them, who saw the mountains of Siberia, and it became a family joke, said, "Lord, they look like the apostles." It's a world he was aware of, especially living in exile in the Berkeley Hills, where his poems could not be published in his home country and were completely unintelligible to the people around him, a world that must have seemed unimaginably far away. He must have had to pinch himself to imagine that it was real, and some of his poems of that period express that. Anyway, his first 10 or 12 years were spent partly in Vilna, the capital, partly traveling with his father on his duty, and partly on his grandparents' farm in Chitanya, near Chitanya, which inhabited his imagination. He went to high school and to the university in Vilna. Spent a year in France after that in the middle 30s, 1934, 1935. Came back, worked in radio. He had a master's degree in law from the university. Worked in radio, was writing, had already published a first book of poems, was working on a second book of poems as 1939 descended on Eastern Europe. And at that moment he made he bolted from Soviet-occupied Vilno to Nazi-occupied Warsaw, where at first he had a job in radio, and then, refusing to cooperate with the Nazis, got a job as a teamster hauling books in a library for the duration of the war. After the war, complicated reasons, he chose to join the Soviet imposed government of Poland and became a diplomat, and went from a completely devastated Poland to Washington, D.C., and then to New York, where he was for a year, where his job as the cultural attaché of the embassy was to provide reports on American culture back to his superiors in the Soviet Union. And he said what he mainly did was paraphrase the Partisan Review to them in articles. And he actually sent, as one of his reports, translation of Wallace Stevens' poem on Portrait of a Pear. In 1949 and 1950, the screws began to tighten on the freedom of writers who had joined the Soviet government. And Czeslaw, at that point, wrote one of the most famous one paragraph or one page essays of the 20th century in a magazine called Cultura, which we're going to say more about before the evening is over. The title of the essay was "No, Nay, I Can't Do It," non serviam, he said, which left him without his language. In France, separated from his family, two small children and his wife in the United States. And for 10 years, he struggled to make a living in Paris as a freelance writer. It was a period when he wrote many of his most remarkable prose works. It was not an easy time for him, because the entire French literary world was left and pro-Stalinist in the 1950s. Not an easy time. In 1960, he was offered a job, halfway around the world at the University of California. And he arrived in 1960 and began teaching Polish literature. He had no education in Polish. I mean, he had a profound education in Polish literature, but he was not trained in it. He said, in fact, the only people who took Polish literature when he was in the university were women who intended to teach grammar school. So men didn't, in that gender-coded thing, study Polish literature. And he found himself lecturing on it. There was no textbook in English on Polish literature, and one of the phenomenal things he did during this period, when he was producing poetry, beginning to translate post-war Polish poetry for the rest of the world, was hire a secretary and dictate in English a history of Polish literature, which is, I think, still the central text on that subject in the world. Anyway, from 1960 to almost 2000, he lived in Berkeley, on the hills in Grizzly Peak, writing poems that could not be published in his own country about the sun going down over the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco Bay. But largely unknown to his contemporaries, though American poets began to show up in his classes. And in 1980, in this world, out of nowhere, he won the Nobel Prize for Literature and suddenly became one of the best known poets in the world. And continued that work for 20 years, and then slowly over time in that period moved back to Poland. After the Soviet Union fell, he was able to return to Poland. After the fall of the Soviet Empire, he was able to return to an utterly transformed Lithuania and at least walk the place where, as a child, he had seen the river flow past his grandparents' manor house. And then slowly, first summers, then for longer periods of time, I don't remember the exact chronology, he came to take up full-time residence in Krakow, deeply happy to have the sound of the Polish language around him and young Polish poets around him to talk to in his last years. And he died in August of 2004 in Krakow. After his death in the cathedral in the great square in Krakow, there were throngs and throngs of people, and considerable political controversy still. But what I remember about it is that the church was heaped with the white flowers of the Lithuanian summer, calamus and the riverside plant that we together looked in three or four different botanical dictionaries to find an English name for. The unfortunate name in English was a fig word, a white fig word, where these flowers in this enormous chapel with all of the major figures of Polish literary and political culture. In the church, and he was buried in Krakow, in the crypt of St. Peter of the Rock, and that was 94, 7 years ago. Can that be right? It's only 7 years ago that he's been gone from us, and it's him, his life, and his art that we're celebrating tonight. Our format is going to be, first we're going to introduce our guest who's come the farthest. We asked Adam Zagajewski, who's not only a Polish poet, but one of the most brilliant and distinguished European poets of his generation, and a poet, younger poet, whose work made Czeslaw feel alive to Polish poetry, I know from sitting up on Grizzly Peak and Czeslaw's sight translating Adam's poems to me, very excited at this book he'd come across published by the same Institut Literackni that had published Czeslaw's early poems. Adam lives in Krakow and spends one semester a year at the University of Chicago, and we're very grateful that he's here in Berkeley tonight to help us honor the memory of Czeslaw Miłosz. Please welcome him.
Good evening. I have my tweed jacket, but I put it away because it's very hot. So I'll just get some water. Maybe I'll read for you just one poem of mine. It is a poem written here, or actually conceived here on the campus of the University UC in Berkeley. I was staying in the faculty club in a faculty hotel, and there was on television, they were showing the film Shoah by Lanzmann. And it was a memorable evening for me. So I dedicate this poem to Milosz. He came to the dinner, so the entire stay was dedicated to him. Watching Shoah in a hotel room in America. There are nights as soft as fur on a foal, but we prefer chess or card playing. Here, some hotel guests sing happy birthday as the one-eyed TV nonchalantly shuffles its images. The trees of my childhood have crossed an ocean to greet me coolly from the screen. Polish peasants engage with a Jesuitical zest in theological disputes. Only the Jews are silent, exhausted by their long dying. The rivers of the voyages of my youth flow cautiously over the distant, unfamiliar continent. Hay wagons haul not hay, but her, their axles squeaking under the feathery weight. We are innocent, the pines claim. The SS officers are haggard and old. Doctors struggle to save their hearts, lives, consciences. It's late. The insinuation of drowsiness have me. I would sleep, but my neighbors choir happy birthday still louder. Louder than the dying Jews. Huge trucks transport stars from the firmament. Gloomy trains go by in the rain. I'm innocent, Mozart repents. Only the aspen, as usual, trembles, prepared to confess all its crimes. The Czech Jews sing the national anthem. Where is my home? There's no home. Houses burn, the cold gas whistles within. I grow more and more innocent, sleepy. The TV reassures me, both of us are beyond suspicion. The birthday is noisier. The shoes of Auschwitz in pyramids high as the sky groan faintly, alas. We outlived mankind. Now let us sleep, sleep. We have nowhere to go. I'm intimidated by the presence of so many people who had known Czeslaw Miłosz much longer than I had. Well, Tony Miłosz had known him for a very long time, certainly. Maybe in the beginning he wasn't sure who his father was, but later he knew. There's a book of memoir just published, memoirs on Czeslaw Miłosz. It's called An Invisible Rope. There are memoirs written by people who knew him well. I tried to remember, to put on paper my remembrances. And I came to the conclusion, I really didn't know him well. I thought that he was an ecstatic person. His ecstatic poems, were written in solitude. We never saw him when he wrote his poems. I had this image of that, you know, when he came, when he drank wine with his friends or vodka sometimes. He was this wonderful smiling person, but his real life was not in these moments. His real life was with the poems, with in these moments of ecstasy. So he was like one of these ships that you come to harbor, you see a ship that they're standing or very peaceful, and there are people taking the sun bath, but this ship was in a hurricane, and you look at this ship and you don't know, you cannot guess what were the adventures of the ship. So this was Milosz. We knew him from the harbors. We never saw him at the full sea. We never saw him in the hurricane, and he was in many hurricanes. It's always so difficult to talk about him. I don't know any other modern contemporary poets that would be so difficult to grasp. He was not like there was something unique and exceptional about his approach to poetry. If you look at poetry written in the 20th century, there were some poets, wonderful poets, who were looking for the newness of poetry, like Apollinaire. There was this avant-garde in poetry. And they were great poets. Apollinaire was a wonderful poet, and Milosz loved his work. There were some other poets, like, let's say, the Italian poet Eugenio Montale, a great poet too. I don't think that Montale was so interested in the newness, in the avant-garde. I think he was interested in expressing himself, in creating a voice, a poetic voice. But this was not the case of Milosz. There was not the newness, it was not the voice. I think that he had the hubris, the ambition. He tried to grasp the totality of the world. There are very few poets in the 20th century who dared to attack the world in its totality. And they mostly failed. There's this wonderful, very moving example of the Austrian poet who's not so well known in this country, Hugo von Hofmannsthal, who was one of the great poets of the 20th century. And he tried to grasp the totality. He knew very well his tradition. He knew everything about poetry, and he felt himself to be the heir of this long line of great poets. He wrote several fantastic poems, and yet, in a way, he failed. He stopped writing poems when he was 20-something, and this is one of the most beautiful ruins. His poetry is this ruin of this ambition to grasp the totality. Maybe Rilke tried to grasp the totality of the world as well. Maybe Eliot and Milosz, certainly. He would never say so openly, but this was his ambition, to see everything. He didn't want to express himself. Mostly poets try to express themselves. We are men and women, we have our lives, we have our sufferings, our joys, and we try to tell our neighbors, our generation, who we are, what we are. But this was not his ambition. He was not interested in saying the world who he was. He tried to grasp the world. Did he succeed? This is an open question. He tried, his poetry was always twofold. There were always two different approaches. Like under maybe the most amazing period in his creation was the Nazi occupation in Warsaw, where he became a very mature poet. He wrote several sequences of poems. There's one sequence called The World, and this is the world as it should be. That's this beautiful world where everything is in order. And this was written, you know, he was sitting in his room and he was listening. He heard the pace of the Nazi soldiers in the street. And yet he dreamed of this ideal world, of the world of order, where there's a father and a son and the mother, and when there's the faith, hope, and joy, and all this in this terrible environment. And then the other sequence is called The Voices of Poor People, and that's the opposite. That's the catastrophe. That's what happened to the world. But even in this, in The Voices of Poor People, there's this poem in this sequence called The Poor Poet, and the first stanza goes like this. The first movement is singing, a free voice filling mountains and valleys. The first movement is joy, but it is taken away. So this is written under the Nazi occupation, and the first movement is joy. That's Miłosz. That's the answer to the hell of the Nazi occupation. The first movement is joy. And then there's another poem in this, written right after the war. It's called Dedication, where he says, he addresses, we presume, a young poet, someone who died in the war, who was killed by the Nazis, and who was probably a nationalist who responded to the appeal of the war fervently as a patriot, and more as a nationalist. And he starts his poem, Miłosz starts his poem, he's saying, you whom I could not save, listen to me. Try to understand the simple speech, as I would be ashamed of another. I swear, there is in me no wizardry of words. I speak to you with silence, like a cloud or a tree. What strengthened me for you was little. You mixed up farewell to an epoch with the beginning of a new one, inspiration of hatred with lyrical beauty, blind force with accomplished shape. And then two stanzas farther he says, what is poetry which does not save nations or people? A connivance with official lies. That's the poet who tries to grasp the totality. And there's also this, in this line, what strengthened me for you was little. There is this charming arrogance of me. You know, he's talking to someone who's dead, and he tells me, I am stronger than you were. That's the entire me. That's this charm of arrogance, of feeling of his strength. But his poetry knew everything, knew also moments of deep despair and melancholy, knew moments of consolidation and fragmentation. Many of young American poets who now claim that fragmentation is the best thing in poetry would say, yeah, he's ours. He fragments. But then he would consolidate. There was this permanent rhythm between fragmentation and consolidation, between doubt and the renewal of faith. I have so little time, and I'm not so arrogant. To give you an example of this. A few lines of fragmentation. That's a poem, The Separate Notebooks. But it's from the 80s, so it's now we jump to the 80s. So these are lines, I played in a meadow by the tents of the Red Cross. That was the time assigned to me, as if a personal fate were not enough. In a small archaic town, the bell on the city hall clock chimed midnight as a student, and so on. How to speak, how to tear apart the skin of words. What I have written seems to me now not that, and what I have lived seems to me now not that. When Thomas brought the news that the house I was born in no longer exists, neither the lane nor the park sloping to the river, nothing. I had a dream of return, multicolored, joyous. I was able to fly. And then next to it, there's another, this is just a fragment, I'm sorry, but I've got only 20 minutes. I probably already speak for 45. And there's this poem, Bypassing Reader Card, who's the poem of consolidation. So after you have this fragmentation, you have this pleasure of fragmentation, this feeling that the world cannot be grasped in a clear way. It has to be rendered through fragments, through small pieces. And then comes this poem, which is like a synthesis, where this proud synthesis, bypassing Reader Card. Bypassing Reader Card, I descended toward the Seine, shy, a traveler, a young barbarian just come to the capital of the world. We were many, from Yassi and Koloshvar, Vilna and Bucharest, Saigon and Marrakesh, ashamed to remember the customs of our homes, about which nobody here should ever be told. The clapping for servants, barefooted girls hurry in, dividing food with incantations, choral prayers recited by master and household together. I had left the cloudy provinces behind. I entered the universal, dazzled and desiring. Soon enough, many from Yassi and Koloshvar or Saigon or Marrakesh would be killed because they wanted to abolish the customs of their homes. Soon enough, their peers were seizing power in order to kill in the name of the universal beautiful ideas. Meanwhile, this city behaved in accordance with its nature, rustling with throaty laughter in the dark, baking long breads and pouring wine into clay pitchers, buying fish, lemon, and garlic at street markets, indifferent as it was to honor and shame and greatness and glory, because that had been done already and had transformed itself into monuments representing nobody knows whom, into arias hardly audible and into turns of speech. Again, I lean on the rough granite of the embankment as if I had returned from travels through the underworlds and suddenly saw in the light of the reeling wheel of the seasons where empires have fallen and those once living are now dead. There's no capital of the world, neither here nor anywhere else. And the abolished customs are restored to their small fame. And now I know that the time of human generation is not like the time of the earth. And to my heavy sins, I remember one most vividly, how one day, walking on a forest path along a stream, I pushed a rock down onto a water snake coiled in the grass. And what I have met with in life was the just punishment which reaches, sooner or later, the breaker of a taboo. I think I have to read at least a few lines of this poem in Polish, because I'm a Polish poet, not an American poet, after all. Read a card. Mijając ulicę Descartes, schodziłem ku Sekwanie, młody barbarzyńca w podróży, onieśmielony przybyciem do stolicy świata. Było nas wielu, Zjazd i Koloszwaru, Wilna i Bukaresztu, Sajgonu i Marrakesz, wstydliwie pamiętających domowe zwyczaje, o których nie należało mówić tu nikomu. Klaśnięcie na służbę, nadbiegają dziewki bose, dzielenie pokarmów z inkantacjami, churalne modły odprawiane przez panów i czelać. Zostawiłem za sobą pochmurne powiaty, wkraczałem w uniwersalne, podziwiając, pragnąc. Następnie wielu zjazd i koloszwaru, albo Sajgonu, albo Marrakesz było zabijanych, ponieważ chcieli obalić domowe zwyczaje. Następnie ich koledzy zdobywali władzę, żeby zabijać w imię pięknych idei uniwersalnych. Tymczasem zgodnie ze swoją naturą zachowywało się miasto, gardłowym śmiechem odzywając się w ciemności, wypiekając długie chleby i w gliniane dzbanki nalewając wino, ryby, cytryny i czosnek, kupując na targach, obojętne na honor i hańbę i wielkość i chwałę, ponieważ to wszystko już było i zmieniło się w pomniki przedstawiające nie wiadomo kogo, w ledwo słyszalne arie albo zwroty mowy. Znowu opieram łokcie o szorstki granit nabrzeża, jakbym wrócił z wędrówki po krajach podziemnych i nagle zobaczył w świetle kręcące się koło sezonów. Tam, gdzie upadły imperia, a ci, co żyli, umarli i nie ma już tu i nigdzie stolicy świata i wszystkim obalonym zwyczajom wrócono ich dobre imię i już wiem, że czas ludzkich pokoleń niepodobny do czasu ziemi. A z ciężkich moich grzechów jeden najlepiej pamiętam, jak przechodząc raz leśną ścieżką nad potokiem zrzuciłem duży kamień na wodnego węża zwiniętego w trawie. I co mnie w życiu spotkało, było słuszną karą, która prędzej czy później łamiącego zakaz dosięgnie. So has he grasped the totality? Yes. How can you? It's in ruins, because totality is in ruins. We have the ruins of his poetry. But the totality is still there. So if there are young poets here, don't despair. You can still try to grasp the totality again. And it's not that the world doesn't belong to any single poet. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. It makes me think of what Ezra Pound said at the end of his life in the ruins of the cantos and one of the last fragments of it. He says, it coheres all right, though these notes do not cohere. This evening is sponsored by the chair of poetry and poetics in the English department and by the Townsend Center for the Humanities, and especially by the Institute of Slavic, Eastern European, and Eurasian Studies. The director, Jeff Pennington, is here, and we want to give a special thanks to him for making this possible. Also, Irina Paperno of the Slavic Language Department, who said this has to happen tonight, and it was really her encouragement that made it happen. We have the special honor tonight of having with us Tony Miłosz, Czesław's oldest son, who has, I wanted to say one other thing before I introduce Tony, and that is that to tell you that this display is made, Karina, I'm not going to get your last name proper. Tomczykowska. Karina, Karia Tomczykowska of the Polish Institute made possible these. Please stop and take a look at these pictures of Czeslaw. And later in the reception, we'll get to look at an amazing collection of the early issues from the 1950s of the literary periodical in Paris where Czeslaw was able to publish in the first years of his exile. Yesterday was Tony Milosz's birthday. I always think that we'll at the reception sing happy birthday to you. I think when your father heard anybody singing happy birthday, he immediately thought of the smokestacks of crematoria. And when anybody ever talked about crematoria, he immediately thought about strawberry jam. In his way of grasping the totality, his mind always went to the opposite place in an amazing way. Anyway, we're very lucky to have Tony here. He's a graduate of this university. He's just completed a translation of the poems that his father wrote in his last years. Please welcome him.
This is my father standing in front of the river where he was born. Champagne is right here. So in some of his poems, he mentions the faraway land that he will never go back to. Well, no, here it is. He did go back. And so, yes, the totality is graspable. I wanted to read some poems that are interesting because they are very sound-oriented, and it's something that we don't always get in translation. It's a general rule that, if you will, intellectual content dominates, and it's a big problem. My father's favorite musical instruments were the bass and the drum, although he claimed to like the harpsichord and all of those more refined things. He really felt the bass and the drum. And so he had a tremendous sense of rhythm, and that was something that drove a lot of his poetry. I think in one of the things that in this country, every poet is reflected in translation in only part of his being. The Polish reader sees a very different side than the American or English reader. And my father's poetry is immensely direct. And this is something that's very, maybe even contrary to current fashion in Anglo-Saxon poetry. But to the person who's reading in Polish, the language is, it's a little strange because he always tries to figure out a clever way to not be mundane or find a new angle on things. But the language is very, very direct. And so some of the poems here, I'm very limited in time, as Adam is, we all are here. So I wanted to read a couple of short ones. And I'm not going to read them in Polish, except perhaps for just a half a stanza, so that you can appreciate what the issue is. This particular poem is called In Honor of Reverend Baca. Reverend Baca wrote very funky short line poems in the Baroque period, which were intended theoretically to convey the mortality of human beings and how you'd better be a good Christian. But in fact, they're quite ironic. So to appreciate the irony was not always left to the people who read him. But Baca, so this poem here is called In Honor of Father Baca. And the poem in Polish starts, ach te muchy, wykonują dziwne ruchy, tańczą razem z nami, tak jak pani pani, na brzegu otchłani. So, what in the object is, well, so let's get this in English. So in English, now he's not a sarcastic poet. So we don't take this too sarcastically. The poem goes, oh, those flies, what strange moves they improvise, dancing with us, Mr. Mrs., on the edge of the abysses. The abyss has no legs, it doesn't have a tail, it's lying on its back,
alongside the trail. Hey there, fly girls and fly gentlemen. Nobody will ever know about you, so do it once again. On the turds of cows or on marmalade, have your tricks and escapades, have your escapades. The abyss gives no milk, it needs no cup or plate. What does it do? It waits. And now, I'll mention that in the last years of his life, he wrote a series of poems that really reflects a lot of his personalities, of which there were really many. He was a theological, agnostic poet, an intellectual poet, and a rhythmic and song-oriented poet. So here we have, and also expressed himself in a direct way, maybe even more direct than he did earlier in his life. This poem is called An Old Man Watches TV. Maybe after all, you could cry a little bit instead of grinning for the audience and doing backflips. Just a little reflection might be apropos. Though I'm old and white-bearded, I'm not alone to think so. Each of you makes faces behind which you hide, and no one can guess the lament we carry inside. The deeds you claim as your own are make-believe instead. You'd rather punch a hole in the wall with your head and fly away far, forever free from here, not to count the dreary days nor the years. So this earth doesn't please us as much as it's supposed to. That's what words and music could be composed to. And so to finish this, as we are limited on time, and here is one which is a little bit of a riddle, if you will. Three lines. I pray to my bedside God because he must have billions of ears, and one ear he keeps always open for me. So thank you. Oh, no literary event is complete without a plug. So the volume, Selected Poems and Last Poems, will be coming out this fall, courtesy Echo. And so this is the jacket to look for in the fall, whenever they get around to printing. Thank you.
When Czeslaw arrived in Berkeley in 1960, it was the good fortune for him and for all of us that in the English department was Peter Dale Scott, a Canadian from Toronto, who had been in the diplomatic service of the Canadian government and served in Poland and knew Polish, though he was teaching classics to English majors at Berkeley at the time. And together, Peter and Czeslaw translated some of his first poems translated in English, and two books that had a powerful effect on American poetry, a book called Postwar Polish Poetry and another book which was the Selected Poems of Zbigniew Herbert. Peter went on to write his own amazing poems and his several, many prose books about the underside of American politics in the 20th century. So I'm very pleased to welcome Peter to talk a little bit about Czeslaw.
Thank you, Bob, and thanks to all of you for coming tonight for this great occasion. In 10 short minutes, I wish to share my belief that Czesław Miłosz is perhaps the greatest poet of our lifetime, restoring to poetry a prospect of hope not expressed since the era of Schiller and Mickiewicz. I do not mean greatest in a political sense, as when Adam Michnik described Miłosz as one of the three great inspirations, along with Lech Walesa and Pope John II, John Paul II for Solidarity's expulsion of the Soviet army from Eastern Europe. I mean that Miłosz has preeminently joined that restricted canon of writers from Dante to Blake who, to quote Miłosz, enlarge the true imagination to open, quote, like a grand promise and the human privilege of recovery, just as William Blake prophesied, close quote. Miłosz's multifarious genius cannot be described by any single one of his poems. His poetry, like Blake's or Wordsworth's, strives again and again after the ineffable, with the behavior, to quote an image from his theological tractate, of a bird thrashing against the transparency of a window pane. Thus his achievement, in marked contrast to Herbert's, is best appreciated when read as a whole. Take, for example, I'm going to cover some of the same ground you've already heard. Take, for example, his 10-line poem, Love, a short rhyme inspired by his pastoral Lithuanian childhood and written in deliberately simple speech. Love means to learn to look at yourself the way one looks at distant things, for you are only one thing among many, and whoever sees that way heals his heart, without knowing it, from various ills. A bird and a tree say to him, friend. Then he wants to use himself and things so that they stand in the glow of ripeness. It doesn't matter whether he knows what he serves. Who serves best doesn't always understand. This understated poem, telling the reader in 10 lines how to heal his heart, can hardly be persuasive by itself. To be so uplifted, one must read the entire sequence, the world, of which love is a part. And the world, functioning in the same way as Blake's Songs of Innocence, is balanced in the same volume by the celebrated witness poems, such as A Poor Christian Looks at the Ghetto, which are analogous to Blake's Songs of Experience. In short, the poem Love gains meaning as Miłosz's dramatic response to Warsaw's destruction in 1944 going on around him, a time when Miłosz also wrote, I want to sing of festivities, the greenwood into which Shakespeare often took me. Leave to poets a moment of happiness, otherwise your world will perish. It is madness to live without joy. The sequence, the world, is thus vital to the function expressed by the book's title, Ocalenie. Miłosz in the 1960s chose to translate this title by the more secular and rearward-looking word, rescue. But ocalenie in Polish also means salvation and conveys that, quote, sense of open space ahead, close quote, which Miłosz in his Harvard lectures considered vital to great poetry. Miłosz's own great poem, Dedication, which introduces the volume in the Polish version, sets just such a high standard for poetry. What is poetry that does not save ocala, nations, or people? A connivance with official lies. As I have written elsewhere, Miłosz himself sometimes discounted this challenging question, which should make all us poets in this room very uncomfortable. But in 1946, Miłosz reiterated in prose that, when I wrote in Dedication that I accepted the salvational goal of poetry, that was exactly what I had in mind, and I still believe that poetry can either save or destroy nations. In all of this, Miłosz is ambitiously following the path set out by the Polish wieszcze, or national bards of the 19th century. In his Harvard lectures, he said later that their work constituted, quote, a home for incorrigible hope, close quote, in marked contrast to the endemic pessimism found in the 20th century poetry of Robinson Jeffers or Eliot's Wasteland. In particular, Milosz is both pursuing and refining the achievement of his master and role model, Adam Mickiewicz. The contrast between love and understanding in his poem Love reworks the contrast between love and King Reason in Mickiewicz's ballad, The Romantic. This romantic split between head and heart can be contrasted to Dante's love of Beatrice, which Dante described as not only guided by reason, but indeed the blessing which liberated him to pursue higher truths through and beyond mere Virgilian reason. Milosz's relationship to Dante was complex. On the one hand, he was obsessed, like Dante, with the need to reach what he called a, quote, second space, a world of paradisal perfection beyond this one we inhabit. On the other hand, he acknowledged that his own drives were in great contrast to Dante's sublimated love for Beatrice, who transported Dante with the single greeting, Salve, in the confines of a church. Milosz sums up this paradoxical relationship in his short poem, Dante. In it, he begins by saying, O alchemist Alighieri, how distant from your harmony is that cosmos in which I vanish, not knowing anything about the immortal soul. Milosz's woman in this poem is not seen in a church, but is some, quote, Theodora, Elvira, or Julia, whatever the name, of her with whom I sleep, whom he sees naked in a hotel bathtub. But in the end, he addresses Dante and uses Dante's words, first in Italian and then in Polish, to describe his own unceasing thirst for paradise. And only as once for you, this remains real. La concreata e perpetua sete, the inborn and the perpetual desire del deiformo regno, for a godlike domain, a realm or a kingdom. There is my home. I cannot help it. I pray for light, for the inside of the eternal pearl, l'eterna margherita. Milosz, in this passage, inserts himself into that community of inspired writers who recognize that they, in Augustine's words, are cives sursum peregrini deorsum, citizens up there and aliens down here. On reading, quote, there is my home, botam jest mui dom, an English-speaking reader is likely to think of Wordsworth's realization when the power of imagination came athwart him on the Simplon Pass, that, quote, our home is with infinitude and only there, with hope it is, hope that can never die. But Milosz is also echoing Mickiewicz's comment on that second space in part three of Forefathers' Eve. Quote, I have seen that world. I have been there, touched it with the naked soul. Milosz observes of Mickiewicz's Swedenborgian passage that, quote, this is not strictly Catholicism. But that is not to dismiss it. In his theological treatise, where Milosz speaks at times in the voice of Mickiewicz, and presents himself as at last an heir to mystical lodges like Mickiewicz, he declares of himself that, quote, wandering on the outskirts of heresy is about right for me. Milosz's concern to displace the Mickiewicz of the schools tamed by cliches, who inspired the racist and anti-Semitic Polish nationalists of the Home Army in World War II, and to recover the radical Mickiewicz who believed in liberating all humanity in the spirit of Schiller and Pushkin. This was necessary to Miłosz's lifelong project of combating racist Polish nationalism, in which he pointed out, inter alia, that Mickiewicz's mother, his wife, and even his messianism were perhaps all Jewish. Miłosz's writing helped open the door to the Catholic Jewish Atheist Alliance of Solidarność. But Miłosz also restored Mickiewicz to the larger liberating tradition of Böhme and Blake, the same tradition invoked by Yeats in occupied Ireland and by Robert Duncan in America. In this way, both Mickiewicz and Miłosz himself can be seen as poets of radical hope, a hope, to quote Miłosz, which seems to draw its strength from a belief in the basic goodness of the world. Miłosz had trouble with that, but he did assert it, sustained by the hand of God and the poetry of country people. I predict that Miłosz himself in future, despite all his alienation and self-doubting, will be remembered as the leading visionary in his time of, quote, the open space ahead. Let me close with a few lines from his vigorous and very complex poem, Throughout Our Lands, the world's first global poem, as I once told him, inspired by his arrival at Berkeley in the 1960s, in which he thinks inter alia of the shipwrecked Spanish explorer Cabeza de Vaca, who survived by living naked among savages in Western America. And this is the fragment I'm going to read and close with. And what if Pascal had not been saved? And if those narrow hands in which we laid a cross are just he, entire, like a lifeless swallow in the dust, under the buzz of the poisonous blue flies? And if they all, kneeling with poised palms, millions, billions of them, ended together with their illusion? I shall never agree. I will give them the crown. The human mind is splendid, lips powerful, and the summons so great it must open paradise. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. Think of the way that poem ends with him thinking about Cabeza Vaca and saying every time he's at a dinner party, he just wants to go, one of the last political events in the world in which he saw so much violence and so much terror that I witnessed him being passionately engaged by was the Serbian nationalist attack on Bosnia. And during the time that he was thinking about that, furious about the European response to it, he was reading brilliant reports on what was going on by a political journalist, Mark Danner, who a year later arrived in Berkeley to teach in the School of Journalism and became one of Czeslaw's Berkeley friends in his last years of being here. Please welcome Mark Danner.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is just a joyous occasion. And I really thank Bob, Tony, and the organizers who made this possible. I mean, it's really true, and I should make a confession that where others come here through criticism or scholarship. I come here really through real estate. I am, among other things, I was Czeslaw's tenant in his house in Grizzly Peak, and Bob asked me to speak a little bit about that house, living there, as I still do. I started renting it off and on in 2000. And I'm going to begin just by telling a story. It happened, I guess, going on 7 years ago. It was a Saturday night. I'd been working late. It was a very dark night, and I decided I had to run down to town. This is up on Grizzly Peak in the Berkeley Hills. I had to run down to town to pick something up. I don't know what it was. And this house is a kind of a chalet cottage with this enormous rough stone chimney inside, two-story living room, nestled in these towering, among these towering Monterey pines and redwoods. It's a quite extraordinary place with a path, a rough stone path that leads up to the road. And I knew the path well by then, so I didn't turn on the lights, and the lights didn't work very well anyway, like many other things in the house. So I started staggering up the path. It was quite dark, as I said, and I heard halfway up, "Arr!" And I, you know, all the cliches, the hair on the nape of my neck, I really froze like that, and I convinced myself I hadn't heard it, and I started to move again, and I heard, "Arr!" And I couldn't see what it was, so I gingerly went back to the house, down the path yet again, tried to turn the lights on, they didn't work, looked for a flashlight, I found one, but the batteries didn't work. I finally grabbed a broomstick and walked up the hill with it ahead of me, like a knight of some, you know, decrepitude. And about halfway up, I heard yet again, "Arr!" And I had what at that point, what poets call an epiphany. I said, "Mark, what the hell are you doing?" And I thought, for some reason, I'm not going to go to town this evening. And I sort of retreated back down the hill. I don't know what it was. I slept late the next day. I worked late, slept late the next morning, woke up, I don't know, around 11, and in the backyard, it's a very small backyard outside a bay window, which overlooks indeed the bay, where there are often deer, which I always thought of as Czeslaw's deer, and deer populate the place. Usually there's three deer, a mother and two babies who tend to sit there, and they watch me walk by like somebody watching a tennis match. You know, it's quite an extraordinary thing. I love them. Anyway, on this particular morning, I came downstairs, and there were a crowd of deer, more deer than I had ever seen there before. I've convinced myself in the time since that it was 13, but I honestly don't know the number. But I stood there absolutely rapt, thinking, what is going on? They were literally crowded in this very small space, at which point the phone rang, and I heard a recorded voice over the machine that I recognized as Bob saying, Mark, are you there? I just got a call. I don't want to leave this on your machine, but Czeslaw has just died. And I stood there and heard this, went over to this book, which I brought tonight, which Czeslaw had given me in Krakow the year before, which says, "In Mark Danner, in the name of all generations of deer inhabiting Grizzly Peak, Czeslaw Milosz, March 25th, 2002, Krakow." Now, this is a preposterous story. I completely recognize it. It's ridiculous. It can't be true. And yet it is sort of characteristic of the predicament, I think, of living in Milosz's house, that it is true. And I don't quite know what to make of it. I do know that I feel all the time as I sit in this house and various parts of it that belong to Czeslaw start to conk out. The refrigerator has, the dishwasher has, and partly because of my own inertia and partly because of some kind of overwhelming sentimentality and mystery, I can't seem to get rid of these things. I tend to think that I'm kind of trapped in a sort of web of time and laughter. And of course, it was one of Czeslaw's great subjects in grasping the world. He searched for being partly through time, through the mystery of time. A few years ago, when we were preparing another such tribute, I was sitting reading Year of the Hunter, which is a wonderful book in which the house plays a very large role. And it was during one of these incredible Pacific storms that we've had so many of these past days that trees above were creaking and cracking, and I thought they were going to fall on the house. And I'm reading, trying to get ready to think of what I'm going to say. And I see this note, a visit from the gardener. This is a kind of a diary form, a visit from the gardener who advises me to transplant the feijoa because there's no way to control their growth under the windows. The pines, he confirms, the pines, despite their gigantic height, although there was some talk this winter of their posing a danger to the house because of storms blowing in from the ocean, he confirms are healthy and can stand there for another 20 years. And of course, the joke, of course, I looked at the date and it was almost exactly 20 years. And I heard this kind of giggle, laughter, giggle, echoing through the house. And of course, that we've just had these incredible storms and that deadline has passed us by. I should say that my worship or my attitude toward the deer is absolutely different from his. He wanted to chase them off. He was a gardener. And I see right underneath this note, again, another daily note, attended an afternoon party at Simon Karlinsky's, where Frank Whitfield was presented with a festschrift in his honor. I learned the one way to deter deer is to go to the zoo and buy lion or tiger droppings. Question mark. And it does make me wonder whether he ever actually went to the zoo and bought tiger droppings, but I really like the idea. I'm fascinated by this idea of the grasping of the world. He tried to grasp the world, Adam said. Has he grasped the totality? Yes. Because it strikes me, looking at the metaphysics of Milosz, if you can call them that, that he had a kind of almost a jealousy of objects. He wanted to be the creator. And the poem I'm going to read is about that. But I see also on this same page, proud that my poems have their own life, objects that used not to be and that suddenly emerge through my mediation so that, like Chardin's painting, they will always exist. And whatever may be said about them will exist only in relation to them. How exactly do poems exist, and can poems exist like things do? And if they can't, how frustrating is that? How frustrating is that? Another brief passage from this book, he remarks something that I've often noticed myself, that when you go through a museum, very often in a big gallery, you look, 30 feet away, whatever, you can't see the subject of the painting, and yet you'll know who the artist is. You'll know it's a Corot or Tintoretto. And he says, which means that there exists, I'm not sure how to define it, a tone, a nuance, a melody, which is peculiar to one man only and to no one else, the mark of an individual. And art supplies only a particular occasion for becoming conscious of this. For the painter has managed to express what is his own, but that does not mean that other people lack their own particular note. This may be the sole proof of the immortality of the soul. Other souls are immortals, but poets, painters, and others get to actually express the immortality in a concrete, some kind of concrete object. I'd like to read a poem about girls, women, but I want to just before, let's see, forgive me just a second, girl on a train, okay. There is one other note in this book. He's riding on a train. This is 1987. For the past several years, I've enjoyed France, but in retaliation for the humiliations I once suffered there, which Bob talked about. I beg your pardon. That's not the girls. Bear with me one second. Okay, yes. I boarded the train to Fontainebleau in the summer of 1931. This is 1987. He's on a train. He's thinking back to 31. I was 20 years old. We'd come to Paris as a trio, Robespierre, Elephant, and I, dressed in shirts and shorts. These are two close friends. Because our knapsacks had sunk in the rapids of the Upper Rhine, Oscar had sent me money, this is his cousin Oscar Milosz, and advised me to buy a suit in Saint-Martin. So I was dressed not too elegantly, but respectably. A young woman sat opposite me. Provincial that I was fascinated with her, a Parisian woman. It isn't true that I'm not thinking about her now, he says in 87, 56 years later. In this train, because I am counting, she must have been around 30, let's say, Add 56 years. She would be 86 now. So most likely she's been dead for a long time. He takes up this theme in a poem that hung in the hallway of Grizzly Peak, which was a portrait with Cat, also about where is this woman now, how old she must be. Now we come back to the woman yet again in one of my favorite poems of his, that's also, it seems to me, about somehow grasping the world and the frustrations of it and the challenge of it. It's called Essay, which means to be, being. And you'll see a familiar character. Essay. I looked at that face, dumbfounded. The lights of metro stations flew by. I didn't notice them. What can be done if our sight lacks absolute power to devour objects ecstatically in an instant, leaving nothing more than the void of an ideal form, a sign like a hieroglyph simplified from the drawing of an animal or bird, a slightly snub nose, a high brow with sleekly brushed back hair, the line of the chin. But why isn't the power of sight absolute? And in a whiteness tinged with pink, two sculpted holes containing a dark, lustrous lava. To absorb that face, but to have it simultaneously against the background of all spring boughs, walls, waves, in its weeping, its laughter, moving it back 15 years, or ahead 30, to have. It is not even a desire, like a butterfly, a fish, the stem of a plant, only more mysterious. And so it befell me that after so many attempts at naming the world, I'm able only to repeat, harping on one string, the highest, the unique avowal beyond which no power can attain. I am. She is. Shout. Blow the trumpets. Make thousand-strong marches. Leap. Rend your clothing, repeating only, is. She got out at Raspai. I was left behind with the immensity of existing things. A sponge, suffering because it cannot saturate itself. A river, suffering because reflections of clouds and trees are not clouds and trees. I want to read one more because I think this poses a question to which this poem, in a sense for us, offers a kind of answer. The poem I just read was written in 1954, and it seems to me it has some kind of aesthetic ambition beating in it like a beating heart, a kind of frustration and also a kind of ecstasy. And this is a poem written much later, I think 91, I'm not sure actually, but several decades later in any event, called Meaning. Meaning. When I die, I will see the lining of the world, the other side, beyond bird, mountain, sunset. The true meaning, ready to be decoded. What never added up will add up. What was incomprehensible will be comprehended. And if there is no lining to the world, if a thrush on a branch is not a sign, but just a thrush on the branch, if night and day make no sense following each other, and on this earth there is nothing except this earth, even if that is so, there will remain a word wakened by lips that perish, a tireless messenger who runs and runs through interstellar fields, through the revolving galaxies, and calls out, protests, screams. It seems to me he came to a bit of an answer there, or at least a kind of equilibrium. And it strikes me as not the least joyous of this occasion that we're still listening to him here together, listening to those screams, as he calls them. Anyway, thank you very much.
What we hope now is to let poems wash over you. For the first set of those, some of the poets who became American poets, Berkeley poets who became Czeslaw's friends and comrades. And so first in this order, Jane Hirshfield, Meryl Natchez, and Brenda Hillman. please welcome them one at a time.
Well, I am so moved to be here with everybody, remembering and treasuring our great poet. And the poem I'm going to read, I think we're already beginning to build a refracting jeweled net of interconnected comments. The poem that I had picked to read, it's one of my favorites of his. It begins in the Grizzly Peak House, and it certainly covers such a range that one could say that it is very much a poem of holding the totality. And also, one note which hasn't been so mentioned yet, Czeslaw Miłosz's great intimacy, his absolute intimacy with things, people, everything was individual, everything was I-thou. It was all personal for him. And the other thing that this poem will touch on when we get there is one of the things that I always found in his work, and the last time I saw him in Krakow in 2002, asked him about, was poems. Tony had mentioned that he was many people, and one of his one of the things he went back and forward on was allegiance to the earthly or allegiance to the other side of the lining. And this is a poem which addresses that as well. Winter. The pungent smells of a California winter, grayness and rosiness, an almost transparent full moon. I add logs to the fire, I drink and I ponder. In Olava, the news item said, at age 70 died Alexander Rimkiewicz, poet. He was the youngest in our group. I patronized him slightly, just as I patronized others for their inferior minds, though they had many virtues I couldn't touch. So I am here, approaching the end of the century and of my life, proud of my strength, yet embarrassed by the clearness of the view. Avant-gardes mixed with blood, the ashes of inconceivable arts, an omnium gatherum of chaos. I pass judgment on that, though marked myself. This hasn't been the age for the righteous and the decent. I know what it means to beget monsters and to recognize in them myself. You, moon, you, Alexander, fire of cedar logs. Waters close over us, a name lasts but an instant. Not important whether the generations hold us in memory, great was that chase with the hounds for the unattainable meaning of the world. And now I am ready to keep running when the sun rises beyond the borderlands of death. I already see mountain ridges in the heavenly forest where, beyond every essence, a new essence waits. You, music of my late years, I am called by a sound and a color which are more and more perfect. Do not die out, fire. Enter my dreams, love. Be young forever, seasons of the earth.
When Bob asked me to select a poem to read tonight, I consulted with my husband, who first introduced me to Czeslaw in the early 80s. I had thought it was before he won the Nobel Prize, because how could we have just gone in there and asked if we could translate a poem of his? But apparently it was 4 or 5 years later. He was very accessible. And he was doing a reading with Bob at that time and gave me this poem to translate. I was working on Polish poetry, which eventually we translated the poems of Tadeusz Borowski, which Czeslaw had absolutely no interest in that project because Borowski was a communist hack and his poems didn't deserve to be translated. But he was generous in other ways. And anyway, Larry suggested this poem that I had completely not only forgotten about, but forgotten that I translated. And so I just want to say that I forgive him all the thousands of boxes of broadsides and books of poetry that I have hauled around for 30 years because the occasional treasure like this one emerges. There's no title. Pure beauty, benediction. You are all I gathered from a life that was bitter and confused, in which I learned about evil, my own and not my own. Wonder kept dazzling me, and I recall only wonder, the risings of the sun in boundless foliage, flowers opening after the night, universe of grasses, a blue outline of mountains and a shout of hosannas. How many times I thought, is this the truth of the earth? How can laments and curses be turned into hymns? Why do I pretend when I know so much? But the lips praised on their own, the feet on their own were running. My heart was beating strongly, and the tongue proclaimed adoration. Thanks.
Good evening. I wanted to thank you for coming out and just to say that we're listening to Czeslaw's poems tonight, mostly in English, and I just wanted to acknowledge the presence of several of his translators because I knew Czeslaw through a little bit through personal acquaintance, but because Bob almost every Monday would go and they would work together in translations and sometimes only work on one line. And so I know many of you are doing translations and it's very important work. So I'd like to give a round of applause to the translators in the room. And I wanted to read Meryl, and I didn't confer, but her poem quoted from The Rising of the Sun, the line, and I wanted to read the first section of that long poem from The Rising of the Sun, which is also from the book by that title. It was published in the mid-70s. This translation is by Lillian Valley, and you'll hear the influence of Eliot and Whitman and all kinds of things that have been said tonight will ring true about this poem too. His wrestling about existence and the physical world and eternity. And this section is in multiple voices. He was a modernist in that way, and he was really trying to get the stages of the mind as it thinks through the various problems and the sense of his own exile. This section is called The Unveiling. Whatever I hold in my hand, a stylus, reed, quill, or a ballpoint, wherever I may be, on the tiles of an atrium, in the cloister cell, in a hall before the portrait of a king, I attend to matters I have been charged with in the provinces, and I begin, though nobody can explain why and wherefore, just as I do now under a dark blue cloud with a glint of the red horse. Retainers are busy, I know, in underground chambers, rustling rolls of parchment, preparing colored ink and sealing wax. This time I am frightened, odious rhythmic speech which grooms itself and of its own accord moves on. Even if I wanted to stop it, weak as I am from fever, because of a flu like the last one that brought mournful revelations when, looking at the futility of my ardent years, I heard a storm from the Pacific beating against the window. But no, gird up your loins, pretend to be brave to the end because of daylight and the neighing of the red horse. Vast lands, flickering of hazy trains, children walk by an open field, all is gray beyond an Estonian village. Roisa, captain of the cavalry, Mojan, angry gales. Never again will I kneel in my small country by a river, so that what is stone in me could be dissolved, so that nothing would remain but my tears, tears. Chorus. Hope of old people never assuaged. They wait for their day of power and glory, for a day of comprehension. They have so much to accomplish in a month, in a year, to the end. It rolls along, sky-like, in the sun, on its islands, in the flow of salty breezes. It flies past and does not, new and the same. Narrow sculptured boats, 100 oars on the stern, a dancer beats baton against baton, flinging his knees. Sonorous pagodas, beasts in pearl-studded nets, hidden staircases of princesses, floodgates, gardens of lilies. It rolls along, it flies by, our speech. Chorus. He whose life was short can easily be forgiven. He whose life was long can hardly be forgiven. When will that shore appear from which at last we see how all this came to pass and for what reason? Darkly, darkly, cities return. The roads of a 21-year-old are littered with maple leaves as he walks along one acrid morning, looking through the fences at gardens and courtyards where a black dog barks and someone chops wood. Now on a bridge, he listens to the babble of the river. Bells are resounding. Under the pines of sandy bluffs, he hears echoes, sees white frost and fog. How did I come to know the scent of smoke of late autumn dahlias on the sloping little streets of a wooden town, since it was so long ago, in a millennium, visited in dreams far from here, in a light of which I am uncertain? Was I there, cuddled like a vegetal baby in a seed, called long before the hours, one after another, would touch me? Does so little remain of our labors lasting till evening that we have nothing left except our completed fate? Under the dark blue cloud with a glint of the red horse, I dimly recognize all that has been. The clothes of my name fall away and disappear. The stars in wide waters grow smaller. Again, the other unnamed one speaks for me, and he opens fading dreamlike houses so that I write here in desolation beyond the land and sea. And I wanted to say that at one night, Bob and I were having drinks with Carol and Czeslaw, and I said, you know, I was reading a lot of Gnostic texts, and I was dying to get him to, like, okay, Czeslaw, would you just describe heaven for me? You know, what is the other world? And he said, Brenda, heaven is the third vodka.
And he would say when he came to our house on Friday nights, as a kind of rhyme, when the door opened, vodka, Brenda. That was the phrase. We kept it in the freezer. I'm sure you did as well. Czeslaw for 30 years made his home in what was, when he arrived, one of the brilliant Slavic language departments in this country. The scholars in it were people who educated me in Russian literature, as Czeslaw did in Polish, and that department continues to be a really remarkable place, and a place where the study of Polish literature, because of him, goes on. There are several, I'm not sure how many, we didn't get a chance to talk before this evening, students of Polish poetry here tonight who said they would agree to read. How many of you are here, Jeff? Would you in some order come up and introduce yourself and as you read your poems? Thanks very much. Please welcome them.
So I'm actually not a student in the Slavic department, but an assistant professor. But I am a student of Polish, and it's very much as a student that I encountered Czesław Miłosz's poetry. First, as a teenager in Tashkent, Uzbekistan, through reading Joseph Brodsky, actually, and then as a beginning student in Krakow, where my favorite exercise was reading Miłosz's poems, not understanding anything at all, not looking into the dictionary, and just trying on the sounds and the words, and trying to make sense of the texts without really grasping the totality at all. So the poem that I picked for tonight has been read here before, actually. But I'm still going to read it because, I picked it because it was on YouTube. And Miłosz was reading it. And one of the most magical exercises was reading along with him and practicing the sounds. So of course I can't replicate his reading. I'm apologizing in advance for my heavy Russian accent. I'll read in English rather quickly and then in Polish in this kind of student-like, slow Polish. So this is the poem that you've read before, meaning. When I die, I will see the lining of the world, the other side, beyond bird, mountain, sunset, the true meaning ready to be decoded. What never added up will add up. What was incomprehensible will be comprehended. And if there's no lining to the world, if a thrush on a branch is not a sign, but just a thrush on the branch. If night and day make no sense following each other, and on this earth there is nothing except this earth. Even if that is so, there will remain a word wakened by lips that perish, a tireless messenger who runs and runs through interstellar fields, through the revolving galaxies, and calls out, protests, screams. Now the Polish. Sense. Kiedy umrę, zobaczę podszewkę świata, drugą stronę, za ptakiem, górą i zachodem słońca, wzywające odczytanie prawdziwe znaczenie. Co nie zgadzało się, będzie się zgadzało. Co było niepojęte, będzie pojęte. A jeżeli nie ma podszewki świata, jeżeli drozd na gałęzi nie jest wcale znakiem, tylko drozdem na gałęzi, jeżeli dzień i noc następują po sobie, nie dbając o sens, i nie ma nic na ziemi, prócz tej ziemi. Gdyby tak było, to jednak zostanie słowo, raz obudzone przez nietrwale usta, który biegnie i biegnie, poseł niestrudzony, na międzygwiezdne pola, w kołowrót galaktyk i protestuje, woła, krzycze. Thank you.
Situation where she grew up was she She lived on one side of the lake where people spoke Polish. Then further down the houses, the next houses, they spoke Russian. Then further on, there were people that spoke Lithuanian. The Jews were gone, I'm afraid, but in her generation. And then there were the Belarusians. And then where you went to school depended largely which kids you played with. Now, and the Polish that she speaks is very much like your Polish. And so I appreciate your reading. It's like being at home. So there you go.
Hello. So the poem that I'm about to read was written in 1944 in Warsaw. Sorry, I'm a little short. My poem is rather short as well, so I'll read it once in Polish, and then I'll read it in English so as to build suspense as to its meaning for those of you that don't speak Polish. So it's called A Song About the End of the World. Czyn końca świata, pszczoła krąży nad kwiatem na sturcji. Rybak naprawia błyszczącą sieć, skaczą w morzu wesołe delfiny. Młode wróble czepiają się rynny i wąż ma złotą skorę, jak powinien mieć. W dzień końca świata kobiety idą polem pod parasolkami. Pijak zasypie na brzegu trawnika, nawołują na ulicy sprzedawcę warzywa. I łódka ze żółtym żaglem do wyspy podpływa. Dźwięk skrzypiec w powietrzu trwa i noc gwiaździstą odmyka. A którzy czekali błyskawic i gromów, są zawiedzeni. A którzy czekali znaków i archanielskich trąb, nie wierzą, że staje się już. Dopóki słońce i księżyc są w górze, dopóki ćmiel nie wiedza różę, dopóki dzieci różowe się rodzą, nikt nie wierzy, że staje się już. Tylko siwy staruszek, który byłby prorokiem, ale nie jest prorokiem, bo ma inne zajęcie. Powiada, przewiązując pomidory, innego końca świata nie będzie, innego końca świata nie będzie. Apologize for the accent. And in English, on the day the world ends, a bee circles a clover. A fisherman mends a glimmering net. Happy porpoises jump in the sea. By the rain spout, young sparrows are playing, and the snake is gold-skinned, as it always should be. On the day the world ends, women walk through the fields under their umbrellas. A drunkard grows sleepy at the edge of a lawn. Vegetable peddlers shout in the trees, and a yellow-sailed boat comes nearer the island. The voice of a violin lasts in the air and leads into a starry night. And those who expected lightning and thunder are disappointed. And those who expected signs and archangel trumps do not believe it is happening now. As long as the sun and the moon are above, as long as the bumblebee visits a rose, as long as rosy infants are born, no one believes it is happening now. Only a white-haired old man who would be a prophet, yet is not a prophet, for he's much too busy, repeats while he binds his tomatoes, there will be no other end of the world. There will be no other end of the world. Thank you.
I'm going to follow a tack reading in Polish, which I've learned here largely under the influence of having read Milosz's book on Polish literature and become fascinated by it, and then read in English. And I think it's really relevant here because it talks about sort of the continuing and lasting value of literature, of books. Ale książki. Ale książki będą na półkach prawdziwej istoty, które zjawiły się raz świeże, jeszcze wilgotne, niby istniejąc kasztany pod drzewem i jesieni i dotykany pieszczony tracz jaczeły mimo łun na horyzoncie zamków wyjającowych w powiecie, plemią w pochodzie, planet w ruchu. Jesteśmy, mówiły, nawet kiedy wydzierżano w nich karty albo litery zliwał bujących płomień, o ileż trwalsze od nas, których ułomnie ciepło, stygnie razem z pamięcią, rozprasza się, ginie. Wyobrażam sobie ziemię, kiedy mnie nie będzie. I nic, żadnego ubytku, dalej dziwowisko. Suknie kobiet, mokry jaśmin, pieśń w dolinie. Ale książki będą na półkach, dobrze urodzone, z ludzi, choć te z jasności, wysokości. And yet the books. And yet the books will be there on the shelves, separate beings that appeared once, still wet as shining chestnuts under a tree in autumn, and touched, coddled, began to live, in spite of fires on the horizon, castles blown up, tribes on the march, planets in motion. We are, they said, even as their pages were being torn out, or a buzzing flame licked away their letters, so much more durable than we are, whose frail warmth cools down with memory, disperses, perishes. I imagine the earth when I am no more. Nothing happens, no loss. It's the strange pageant. Women's dresses, dewy lilacs, a song in the valley. Yet the books will be there on the shelves, well-born, derived from people, but also from radiance, heights.
My name is Tony Lin from the Slavic department. And let me just say something before I even start. That was my student in Polish once. I thought she did very well. And the poem I'm about to read, it doesn't have an English translation. So I'm not going to even attempt simultaneous translation here on stage. But the title is called Na małą murzynkę grającą Chopina. And let me just say a few words about why I chose this poem. So I'm writing a dissertation on Chopin, the literary representations, and I try to find, you know, what Milosz wrote about Chopin. So this happens to be one of them. And I also like the idea of, you know, somebody racially different being kind of a messenger for something greater. So this poem talks about how this small black girl playing the works of Chopin. So I'm going to read it in Polish. Na małą murzynkę grającą Chopina. Gdybyś ją widział, panie Federiku, jak ciemne palce kładzie na klawiszach i kędzierzawą głowę pilnie schyla, jak nogę szczupłą stawia na pedale śmiesznie dziecinną, z etapnym buciku. A kiedy sala nagle się ucisza, pierwiosnek dźwięku powoli rozwija. Gdybyś zobaczył na sali w półmroku, jak błyszczą zęby w rozchylonych ustach, kiedy fortepian twoje troski niesie i jak ukośną smugą pada z boku i wrzawą ptaków przez witraże chlusta wiosna w nieznanym z imienia ci mieście. Gdybyś zobaczył, jak te dźwięki fruną i targną pyłem słoneczną kolumną na czarną twarzą na dłoni opartą, pewnie powiedziałbyś, że było warto. Dziękuję.
So in, I also wanted to say that the reception and the advertising and the flowers were made possible by the Holloway Committee, Rosa Martinez and John Shoptaw. Rosa, are you here? Thank you so much for this. So in our last set, poets who, in one case, Jessica Fisher is a graduate student in English, has later become a her own accomplished poet and worked with Czeslaw, worked for him as an assistant and translated a few poems, and poets John Shoptaw, Charles Legere, and Larry Ruth, and C.S. Giscombe in that order, and then we will find our way to a toast. Yes, please welcome them.
Hi, thanks for your stamina, and I still have fond memories of driving up to the house on Grizzly Peak and Czeslaw saying, now you will take dictation. I didn't take dictation for this poem, but I love it, so here it is. The thistle, the nettle. The thistle, the nettle, the burdock and belladonna have a future. Theirs are wastelands and rusty railroad tracks, the sky, silence. Who shall I be for men many generations later, when, after the clamor of tongues, the award goes to silence? I was to be redeemed by the gift of arranging words, but must be prepared for an earth without grammar. For the thistle, the nettle, the burdock, the belladonna, and a small wind above them, a sleepy cloud. Silence. Thanks.
Heraclitus got totality in two words, pantare, it all flows. I'm reading a poem, Rivers, at the back or the mouth of Roadside Dog. So lasting they are, the rivers, only think. Sources somewhere in the mountains pulsate and springs seep from a rock, join in a stream, in the current of a river, and the river flows through centuries, millennia. Tribes, nations pass, and the river is still there, and yet it is not, for water does not stay the same. Only the place and the name persist as a metaphor for a permanent form and changing matter. The same rivers flowed in Europe when none of today's countries existed, and no languages known to us were spoken. It is in the names of rivers that traces of lost tribes survive. They lived, though, so long ago that nothing is certain, and scholars make guesses to which other scholars seem unfounded. It is not even known how many of these names come from before the Indo-European invasion, which is estimated to have taken place 2,000 to 3,000 years BC. Our civilization poisoned river waters, and their contamination acquires a powerful emotional meaning. As the course of a river is a symbol of time, we are inclined to think of a poisoned time. And yet, the sources continue to gush, and we believe time will be purified one day. I am a worshiper of flowing and would like to entrust my sins to the waters and let them be carried to the sea.
Thank you. One of the things about being in a great reading with many great poems is that you're apt to have chosen one to read which has already been read. I have another one, though. Rivers. Under various names, I have praised only you. Rivers. You are milk and honey and love and death and dance. From a spring in hidden grottos, seeping from mossy rocks, where a goddess pours live water from a pitcher, at clear streams in the meadow, where rills murmur underground, your race and my race begin, and amazement and quick passage. Naked, I expose my face to the sun, steering with hardly a dip of the paddle. Oak woods, fields, a pine forest skimming by. Around every bend, the promise of the earth. Village smoke, sleepy herds, flights of martins over sandy bluffs. I entered your waters slowly, step by step, and the current in that silence took me by the knees until I surrendered, and it carried me, and I swam through the huge reflected sky of a triumphant noon. I was on your banks at the onset of midsummer night, when the full moon rolls out and lips touch in rituals of kissing. I hear in myself, now as then, the lapping of water by the boathouse and the whisper that calls in me for an embrace and for consolation. We go down with the bells ringing in all the sunken cities. Forgotten, we are greeted by the embassies of the dead, while your endless flowing carries us on, and neither is nor was the moment only eternal.
Hi, I'm Charlie Legere. This is Alec. We were going to read another poem snatched from us, but we'll trade off on this one instead. Thank you for being here. We're honored. Window. I looked out the window at dawn and saw a young apple tree translucent in brightness.
And when I looked out at dawn once again, an apple tree laden with fruit stood there.
Many years had probably gone by, but I remember nothing of what happened in my sleep. Thank you.
Goodness, I'm what stands between us and the reception. I'm going to read Encounter, the poem which has haunted me since I first read it many, many, many years ago. It's in the web of intricacies that Jane Hirshfield has pointed out, or have developed over this evening, and in this poem are similar concerns to the ones that Mark Danner spoke about in his presentation. Encounter locates itself, it takes the trouble to locate itself, a note in italic at the end of the poem. Vilno, 1936. 3 years before the war, the capital of Lithuania, a hinge city, a medieval, multiply ethnic city fought over last century by the Soviets, the Poles, the Germans. At the confluence of two navigable rivers, the Vilnia, from which the city's name is taken, and the Neris. Encounter. We were riding through frozen fields in a wagon at dawn. A red wing rose in the darkness. And suddenly, a hare ran across the road. One of us pointed to it with his hand. That was long ago. Today, neither of them is alive, not the hare, nor the man who made the gesture. Oh, my love, where are they? Where are they going? The flash of a hand, streak of movement, rustle of pebbles. I ask not out of sorrow, but in wonder. Thank you all for coming this evening.
Thank you all. I think there may be a few more people who want to read poems, and we can do it in the other room. So please join us for the reception. To all the readers, thank you so much for being here. Thank you.